Wanted to take the opportunity to continue discussions about the Safety Act and some of the provisions that relates to the no cash bail or the bailable versus non-bailable provisions. You know, before I get to those, I think there's a couple of things worth pointing out as it relates to a couple of our constitutional officers and the unfortunate desire of them to continue pushing propaganda that not only does nothing to address the real concerns present, but it creates fodder for people to get confused and to get distracted from the real issues. For example, Governor Pritzker recently was asked a question about the Safety Act, and in response, the governor gives an example about a single mother stealing diapers, and as a result of stealing those diapers, she may find herself sitting in jail pending trial for 6 months. That example is completely contrary to any realistic resolution under the law. In the city of Chicago, if someone is charged with a Class A misdemeanor for theft, their maximum bond is $150. They post $150, they get out. Now, if they don't have $150, assuming that worst case scenario of bond setting, there's a law that was passed a few years back that actually gives them credit for $30 a day for every day they're in jail unable to post bond. So the complete, absolute worst set of circumstances for which a hypothetical mother taking diapers would be in jail pending trial is 5 days, not 6 months like Governor Pritzker suggests. Now, the reality it is, under those circumstances, most, if not all, of those alleged criminals aren't sitting in jail at all unless they have some significant other factors, criminal history, etc., that would warrant it. But most of the time, they're let out recogged. But again, Governor Pritzker is trying to say 6 months, create that dramatic situation. It's not realistic. Worst case scenario would be 5 days. As for our Attorney General, Kwame Raoul, Mr. Raoul was somewhere yesterday, and he was asked a couple of questions about the Safety Act. One of the things that Mr. Raoul said that I thought was interesting is that he recognized that the Safety Act needed to be revisited. And what he said is that we often pass legislation that requires a lot of debate. And I thought to myself, the Attorney General should have acknowledged that this law was passed without a lot of debate because it was snuck through the legislature in wee hours of the morning within a day or two. So wouldn't it be nice if we had a system of government where all of the debate over something as broad of a topic as this would have actually occurred before passing it? So to suggest we should go back and revisit it because it didn't get a lot of debate prior to passage, it surprised me that our Attorney General would have acknowledged that these things actually occur. Another thing that Kwame Raoul said that I thought was of interest is that he believed that while the Safety Act needed to be addressed and fixed, he wouldn't get into specifics because he likely may not know, is that it leaves the judges with enough discretion regarding matters of bail. And I thought to myself, our Attorney General is saying to the public that he believes that as long as the legislature leaves some amount of discretion with the judiciary regarding these types of matters, that he is satisfied. He completely fails to acknowledge that the judiciary is an independent branch of government with its own constitutional inherent authority. And the legislature has no ability to impede or to get involved in taking discretion away from the judiciary. So it's not a matter of degree, it's a matter of whether they can or they cannot do it. So again, Kwame Raoul suggesting that this issue of bail still leaves some amount of discretion with the court is a complete refusal to acknowledge the separation of powers. Now, as to this issue of bail, which is a topic of conversation, there's a common misconception that bail is always attributed to cash or some kind of monetary component, which is not the case. Bail in and of itself merely means the ability for an alleged criminal to be released from jail pending trial. That's what bail means. So if an offense is bailable, it means that the alleged criminal under certain conditions can be released. If it's non-bailable, it means that they cannot be released under any set of circumstances. The cash component that is attempting to be eliminated is, should a particular alleged criminal be required to provide some type of financial security to ensure that they're actually going to comply with the conditions of release, or otherwise their bail conditions? Should they have to post any kind of financial security? If they're let out on their own recognizance or a promise, it means that the court is satisfied that their mere promise to comply is sufficient. If cash is required by the court has determined on a case-by-case basis that some amount of financial security is needed to ensure compliance. That's what the cash component is in reference to. Now, as to whether or not offenses are bailable or not bailable is for an issue for the judiciary, and then we have a constitutional principle in the Bill of Rights. Under Article 1, Section 9, it says that all persons shall be bailable by sufficient surety. All persons shall be bailable by sufficient surety. Except, it lists really three different offenses for which an alleged perpetrator may not be bailable. Capital offenses, offenses for which life imprisonment is possible, and one that was added here in recent history is felony offenses for which no probation is possible. So if under the constitutional provision of the Bill of Rights, you may have alleged to have committed one of these categories of crimes, which is very small, and the court is convinced that that person poses a threat to the safety of another person or persons, the court can then hold them without bail pending trial. That's what our Constitution says. Now, there's also a few other provisions with the court and the inherent authority of the court, because the right to bail is not absolute, our Supreme Court has said, even with these limitations placed within the Bill of Rights. The court, under certain circumstances, has some inherent authority to control the administration of justice. So, for example, if the judge is convinced that someone may be a threat to a witness or threat to a juror, or they may otherwise never come back to court under any set of circumstances, the court can deny bail for those alleged criminals, even if it's a non or a bailable offense. So the court has some inherent authority regardless of whether it's bailable or not bailable. That is the court's purview. Now, what we have here, which is where this problem is coming from, the Safety Act, is the legislature, what they're trying to accomplish, one of the many things they're trying to accomplish, is to create numerous categories within Section 6.1 of crimes that they say are non-bailable. They're trying to create a bunch of non-bailable categories, okay? And whether or not the court can detain or not detain those persons depends upon the categorization, among a few other things, by the court. Now, this is not the first time that this has occurred in the state of Illinois, and it's already been addressed on a few different occasions. I would challenge my colleagues and those and others in the legal community to review a couple of cases on this topic to draw the conclusion that the attempted categorization of additional non-bailable crimes above and beyond those enumerated in the Constitution violates our Constitution. There's a case from 1975 called the People v. Hemingway, and it is 60 Illinois 2D74. And in this case, the Illinois Supreme Court made it crystal clear, and I'm reading it to you, to the extent that the section of the criminal code is attempting to render non-bailable offenses, other than those for which the Constitution provides, they're invalid. That's what they said in 1974. Then also in 1995, the Supreme Court took on this issue again and says, to the extent that our legislature is merely trying to codify what is already the authority of the court, that may not be improper, but they can't continue with that legislation to the point to where it takes away or adds to anything the court's doing regarding bail. That's what our courts have said. In that case, is the People v. Bailey, 167 Illinois 2D210. So again, our legislature in the Safety Act is trying to create these categories of bailable offenses, new bailable offenses that exceed those that the Constitution allows. They cannot do that. It is unlawful, it's unconstitutional. The court that we have is set up to administer justice. They get to decide how that justice is administered. Bail is one of the primary components of which they have inherent authority and constitutional authority. The legislature cannot impede that. They can't get into the middle of that. So when Kwame Raoul yesterday, after all of the conversation and pressure that has been put on this issue for the last 3 weeks, suggested we may have to take a look at that, I ask myself and I ask the people of our state to consider, why now, after almost 2 years of having been passed, is Kwame Raoul just acknowledging we may have to look at this? Kwame Raoul had an obligation to all people in this state, including the alleged criminals, to make sure that our legislature doesn't unlawfully impede the system of criminal justice. All of these categories that got created, beyond those enumerated in the Constitution, are clearly unconstitutional because the Hemingway Court and the Bailey Court have said so. Decades ago, they have said so. But yet Kwame Raoul did nothing for almost 2 years, wouldn't even talk about it, even mention it. He violated his oath and his duty to the people of Illinois to raise the issue that I'm bringing in front of you right now. Because up to this point, we've been talking about what this statute says, where it creates these categories and leaves out offenses, serious offenses, that the statute's trying to say you have to let them free. If you remember when we've talked about that, kidnapping, second-degree murder, etc., the legislature trying to say those are not, those can be bailable offenses. Legislature doesn't have any of this discretion, ladies and gentlemen, none whatsoever. It's within the purview of the court to do under the constitutional principles. So where do we find ourselves with nothing changing? That's the question. Where do we find ourselves? We find ourselves with the legislature attempting to put our judiciary in a position of engaging in unconstitutional conduct. Attempting to tell our judiciary, our judges, that if someone has allegedly committed a category of crime that's enumerated in the new statute, that you should detain them. You can detain them. Notwithstanding the Constitution says you cannot. That's what our legislature is trying to do. And that should not be allowed. This legislation has to absolutely be cleaned up. What needs to happen is the state's attorneys across this, there's already been four state's attorneys statewide, bring a cause of action against the governor, Kwame Raoul, and the legislature. That needs to continue, and they need to add to it the component that I'm talking about right now that says that this categorization of all of these crimes as being non-bailable is beyond the authority of the legislature. Merely read the Hemingway case and read the Bailey case, and the legal scholars of our state will see that what they've attempted to do here is improper. That's all I have today. Thank you, unless anybody has any questions.
Tom, it seems to come down to these bailable offenses that everybody seems to be stuck on at this point. If the legislature does not have jurisdiction to place these restrictions, or not restrictions, but items on the court, Where do we go from here on that? I mean, if that's what's going to happen, is that what we're talking about trying to change or take that? Is that just one component, or do we undo the entire Safety Act?
No, the Safety Act, again, has numerous components, you know, and there's been some arguments raised by the state's attorneys, two Democratic state's attorneys, that the single issue rule's been violated, rendering the whole Safety Act void. I agree with those arguments, you know, but that's a separate, broader conversation than what we're talking about with the bail issue. I mean, the cases that I've cited make it clear that the legislature can codify into a law what is already the authority of the court, their constitutional authority that they have regarding bail. These cases are also clear that the legislature can't craft statutes that impedes their authority. They can't do that, which is what they're trying to do here. So I believe the Attorney General could bring a very basic declaratory judgment action against, really, the governors, who he's going to have to do it against. You know, is he going to do that or not? Saying that all of these categories that have been created under the Safety Act, under 725.5/110-6.1, all of those categories, to the extent they are broader in scope than those enumerated in the Constitution, exceeds the authority of the legislature. That's what needs to happen, 100%.
And what is your message to voters that will go to the polls on November 8th? What do you want them to hear?
The message to the voters that I want them to hear is that this issue that we're talking about right now, it's been pending in our state for almost 2 years. Now, they snuck it through in the middle of the night and got it passed without the public really knowing about it. Kwame Raoul played a material part in that process. He was fundamental in the orchestration and passage of the Safety Act. After that, the Attorney General's office did nothing to deal with it. He didn't bring any action saying that this is an unconstitutional invasion by the legislature. He sat idle. I want the people of our state to understand that if I'm the Attorney General, these types of actions that have been engaged in, this overreach of the legislature into the judiciary, which is what this is, would not be tolerated by our office. We would absolutely defend the separation of powers. You know, look, we've had Governor Pritzker for the last 2.5, almost 3 years, invading the purview of our legislature. He's been creating laws through executive authority, and we sat by and far too long allowed that to happen. This Safety Act is just another version of overreach by the legislature in conjunction with Pritzker. Governor Pritzker's, he's in the middle of all of this. So the legislature, working in concert with Governor Pritzker, are trying to interfere and impede the authority of the judiciary. It's another power grab into another branch of government, and our Attorney General has sat by and idly allowed this to happen, and only now, after it's being talked about, at the extent it's being talked about, does our Attorney General even give it any lip service by saying, yeah, we probably ought to look at that. I'm sorry, Mr. Attorney General, you need to bring action, and you need to put an end to it.
Tom, a lot of people on the other side of the aisle, they like this bill because they are thinking about the indigent, you know, alleged criminal, and saying, like, why should that person have to spend money when people who are maybe wealthy, they don't have to, you know, they don't have to spend money. So that's what they look at with the cashless bill. But I want your response on this. Doesn't that just mean that more alleged criminals are getting out easier? And how do you weigh the equitable concerns of that indigent person versus all of our interests as a society to have fewer alleged criminals, making it so easy for them to commit crime again?
You know, we could spend probably weeks having the conversation of the question you just asked, but there's something to be said about making sure that people aren't unnecessarily held in jail merely because of some financial limitation. I would suggest to you that that's not as pervasive as they try to make it seem, but it's certainly a conversation. But regardless of that being a conversation worth having, the resolution can never be that we craft legislation that's unconstitutional. That's not a result. So that's my quick answer to you, is that what they've tried to put in place goes so far that it pushes against the separation of powers, it pushes against the Bill of Rights of the state of Illinois. That's never an appropriate response. You know, another thing that I have just written down that someone wanted me to add, to talk about, is it appears that yet another legislator has been indicted by the federal government, I believe Mr. Jones. So I have read about now Mr. Jones has been charged with bribery as it relates to some red light camera legislation, it seems. And what I found interesting about that, I think it's worth the people of our state recognizing, is that this is the ninth public official in the state of Illinois in approximately 3 years to has been indicted by the federal government. Nine. And we have had zero indicted by our own attorney general. He's not indicted anyone for public corruption. I think that should be telling to the people of Illinois. North to south, wherever I go, they're tired of public corruption. They're tired of politicians like Mr. Jones, who is alleged to have wanted to engage in legislative conduct and try to get some money for himself, and they were actually trying to figure out how they could get money to him without anybody finding out. That, why is that not prosecuted by the Attorney General of the state of Illinois? He should absolutely be prosecuting those crimes instead of us relying upon the federal government. So I appreciate the federal government getting involved and trying to help eliminate corruption in our state. I wish our Attorney General would do more. The people of Illinois make me the Attorney General. We won't need the federal government anymore. I will prosecute all of these corrupt public officials myself, I promise you.
Thanks for watching, and if you haven't already, please consider subscribing to our channel. And while you're at it, please leave us a comment. Thank you for watching.